perpetual parish priest of SFX. Brothers and sisters, on behalf of the PPC, I welcome you all to the 34th Annual Pastoral Assembly of SFX. Briefly, the program for the day. Shortly after this, Father Albert will give us a welcome address. 2:30, a presentation by Father Clarence. 3:15, there will be a group discussion here. 4 p.m. tea. 4:15, reporting from various groups from the discussion that we had. And 4:45, address by His Grace, Archbishop. And we conclude at 5:15 p.m. Okay. Now I have the pleasure of calling Father Albert, parish priest, to give us a welcome address.
It was not like this. I had to change glasses when I read. I had grown old, people tell me. First and foremost, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for making an effort to come for this pastoral assembly. And to take no credit of it, because you come here not because of me, because you want to meet our dear new Archbishop. This place, you are here. I'd like to really thank you, Your Grace, for taking this time. I know you have a very busy schedule since you took over the office of Archbishop of Kuala Lumpur. And I know that it is really testing for you to travel from places to places to meet new communities, both outskirts and within the Penang Valley. So I appreciate and really grateful for your presence here. I'd like to thank the organizing community too for making efforts to make this pastoral assembly possible and also comfortable. I have been here parish, working in this parish of St. Francis Xavier for almost 8 years. 4 years as your assistant parish priest and almost 4 years now as your parish priest. Looking back, these past 8 years has filled me with great joy because I can see the tremendous outpouring of God's love and grace on our parish community. We have become more and more a prayerful community. Many people who are passing through our parish have approached me to convey their appreciation for the way we pray and worship on Sunday Masses, also for the hospitality and love they have experienced from our community. I have also seen an increase in the number of people coming for confession before Mass, and it is really a grace-filled experience for me, because large majority of those who come for confession are moved by love of God and for God, rather than the fear of hell or punishment. In short, there is an increase in the desire to grow more intimate in our relationship with God. For that, I truly am thankful to God for the graces we have experienced. On the other hand, the faith that we profess and the value that should form and inform our way of living as children of God often remain a Sunday phenomenon. For so many of us, there is a disconnectedness between faith and life, especially daily life. To put it simply, there is a disconnectedness between knowing what the church teaches with regards to our faith and being moved by a personal love of and commitment to God to live that faith in our daily life. It is not something new. In fact, it is the struggle of the universal church throughout history. The struggle against apathy, individualism, and self-centeredness in the life of the faithful. How do we become truly and genuinely a faith-centered community, a community whose faith is reflected in our daily life? I've been reflecting on these questions for the past 4 years as your parish priest, and I came to the realization that conversion brought about by a genuine religious experience vis-a-vis a personal experience of God's love for us is essential. In that, I am consoled by the fact that God already loves each one of us. What is needed from us is to open our hearts to receive that love. This is not as easy as it sounds, because most of us, if not all of us, do not really want to be loved by God the way God wants to love us. There are many reasons for this resistance. I would like to highlight at least two of them. The first is that many of us are afraid to surrender control of our life. We are afraid that if we allowed to be loved by God the way God wants to love us, we must live by the value and the teachings of the gospel to submit to God as King and Master of our life and destiny. The truth is, we want to be the master of our own destiny and the author of our own life. We want to be king of our world, the first among equals. We want to be held in high esteem by our peers, to be somebody in the eyes of the world through riches, power, or fame. We are very much attached to this world. In order to be open to receive God's love the way God wants to love us, humility is essential. The self-centered and self-serving ego must decrease in order to make room for God. To paraphrase St. Paul, I must decrease so that Christ may increase in me. The second is related to the first in that, in our quest to be first in the world, we have hurt others, which is the sin, and in turn, hurt by others, and we experience brokenness. And hence, we carry so much sin and brokenness within us, the wounds and scars that we carry in us make us self-absorbed and inward-looking. In other words, we are not open to receive God's love for us because we are overwhelmed by past experiences of pain and suffering. Consciously or unconsciously, these hurts that we have experienced in our life have made us less than who we are called to be in relationship with others. We see this when there is a lack of charity, and also when aggression, insecurities, and the need to dominate surfaces. In order to be a faith-centered community, a community whose faith is reflected in our daily life, we need to recognize and accept the brokenness within us, because only by doing so can we accept the fact that we are not free from our past, and we need God's grace of healing in order to move forward. The recognition of our sinfulness, on the other hand, is also essential for being a faith-centered community. We cannot make excuses for our behavior and actions that cause hurts and sufferings to others. In other words, we cannot point to our own brokenness as the cause of our sin. Despite our brokenness, we are nevertheless responsible for the choices that we have made and the bad things that we have done. It is only by taking responsibility of our sin that we come to the realization that we cannot save ourselves. We need God's mercy and love. And second, we need forgiveness for one another. In short, It is only when we take responsibility of our sin that true reconciliation with God and with one another is possible. Without reconciliation with God and one another, there is no genuine peace and community. Finally, to be a faith-centered community, a community whose faith is reflected in our daily life, we must have a genuine, personal, and intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. Having a personal and intimate relationship with Jesus is of utmost importance for us to be genuine Christians. Without a personal and intimate relationship with Christ, our faith can become artificial and or legalistic. In other words, without this relationship, our faith is reduced to only Sunday worship and external observances of obligations and laws of the church. It is an empty shell, faith that is without substance. To enter into a personal and intimate relationship with Jesus requires two essential elements: faith knowledge of Jesus and a good and sustained prayer life. Faith knowledge can be attained through study of scriptures, especially the New Testament, and the teaching of the church about Jesus, Christology. You cannot have a relationship with someone you do not know at all. A good and sustained prayer life, on the other hand, should nurture our personal relationship with Christ by this interiorization of faith into prayer. We can and are transformed in how we live our daily life. By this relationship, all our decisions and actions are formed and informed by the gospel values, which is the teaching of Christ, and guided by our conscience. If we have a genuine and personal and intimate relationship with Jesus, all the challenges that we may face in our daily life, be it our relationship with parents, spouse, children, friends, colleagues, or subordinates, we are able to situate these challenges in the context of our faith. What did Jesus teach us? What would Jesus expect me to do? And if Jesus is here now, what would Jesus do? Jesus cannot remain an idealized image in our mind, but a real and living God. Christ becomes real only when we have a real relationship with Him. It is this love for God and for Jesus Christ that not only binds us together in communion with one another, but also call us to do loving service to one another and our neighbor, our non-Christian brothers and sisters. A community that is inward-looking and care not about the needs of others leads to atrophy and death. Moreover, for us Christian, love for God necessitates love for neighbor, which is the two inseparable commandments Christ Jesus has given us. Our love for one another and for our neighbor cannot remain at the level of feeling or emotion alone. It must flow into genuine work of charity. As St. James said, faith without work is dead. With this in mind, I'm changing the vision and mission statement of St. Francis Xavier Parish to the following. We are a community of broken and sinful people, yet loved by God, who desires that through our intimate relationship with Jesus, we may be made whole to love and serve one another and our neighbor. The official propagation of this vision and mission statement will take place in the unveiling ceremony on the 4th of January. based on this vision and mission statement, there are six key areas which I would like the parish to focus on. The first, an awareness of our need of God's salvific love and grace. Second, interior knowledge of our own brokenness and sinfulness. Third, enabling the development of a personal and intimate relationship with Jesus. Fourth, building the bond of community life. Fifth, fostering holistic development and healing. And finally, loving service to one another and reaching out to other people in need. I pray that with this new vision and mission statement, we can journey together as a community toward a greater love of God and commitment to service of one another and our neighbor. May God bless all of you.